That's not the only thing Jesus came to do.
Amen.
Right, amen.
Jesus came to establish a church.
Yes, Lord. Amen.
Where the Word of God can be taught.
Amen.
And I can come in and be a hearer.
Amen.
Of the Word of God. Now, you know why God did that?
And to do it.
You know why God created the church? Because the Bible said, in a multitude of counselors, there's safety.
Amen.
I can sit at home and study my Bible and form opinions that are not in God's way. I can form thoughts in the Bible that are not in God's way. But what brings it to a head or a understanding is when I come and I speak or I hear and I understand what was being said, and the Holy Ghost blesses it and touches it, and it's found common with everyone in the assembly, and we start praising God and glorifying God. There's safety in that, I would say. How many can see that? There's safety in that. So the Lord has provided that. All right. I'm going to find a jumping off place here. Never get anything done. Paul desired to serve the indwelling spirit instead of the sinful flesh. We did that, didn't we?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
If he had been led by the old, by his old nature, one questioned whether he was truly saved. If he's led by his own nature, old nature, would he be saved?
No.
But if the spirit of him, and we read that, once we have come to the to possessing the spiritual life by means of the implanted spirit, after having been born again, it is impossible for dead flesh to rule over live spirit.
Amen.
On a permanent basis. 1 John 3 and 33 and 6 makes this statement. Whosoever abideth in him sinneth not. Whosoever sinneth hath not seen him, neither known him. Wow, that's a plain statement, isn't it?
Yes, amen.
Somebody said, well, I sinned. Yesterday I sinned, today I sinned, today I sinned, or I sinned a few minutes ago. But God has provided a method there. Once you get saved and you put your life into the kingdom of God, into the Word of God, you start reading that Bible, you know what you have? You've got your private attorney.
Yep.
And you don't have to pay him $100,000 like Ben Matlock. Or hope for a charity case with Barry Mason. He stands right with you. The Bible calls him an advocate. That advocate pleads to the Father.
Yes, he does. He's my face.
But if you sin willfully, the Bible said if you sin willfully, there remaineth no more sacrifice. What's the sacrifice?
Jesus.
Now, if he's an advocate, while you're striving and you're trying to do right, and yet you slip, and Jesus stands there pleading your case. His blood covers you.
Amen.
That doesn't mean that your sin is right.
No.
But he sees you striving. And in the utmost, rather in the target that you have to be an overcomer, that will be accomplished if you stay in the will of God. I strive daily. Strive daily. Somebody said, how do you strive? Well, I strive just like Jesus did.
Amen.
Jesus wanted to do the will of the Father, did he not?
Yes.
And then some hideous being with horns and a tail and a pitchfork took him up on top of a mountain. Now, we know that's ridiculous.
Thank you.
He went into the mountain. He was brought there by that spirit that he inherited from his mother.
Yep.
He went into the top of that mountain, and that spirit started talking to him.
Yes.
And you know what Jesus relied on?
It is written. Yes.
Every time he was tempted while he was on top of that mountain, somebody said, well, what was it? He was tempted with this and tempted with that. Is that really relevant right now, what I'm talking about?
No.
The relativity of this is?
It is written.
It is written.
Amen.
Amen.
You know, the Bible said that we are more than conquerors.
Yes, yes we are. Amen.
Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Yes.
Now, man before this time did not have that in their lives. And they couldn't bring the righteousness of the law into existence in their life. But God sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, he condemned sin.
Yes.
When did he do that? It is written.
Yeah. It is written.
It is written. The man said, no, it's when he went to the grave. No, when he went to the grave, he was the sacrifice.
That's right.
For our sins.
Yes.
But when he lived here in this world, he said, I come to do the will of the Father.
Yes.
He walked according to how he was led.
Yes.
Now, you think God just started speaking to him every time he did something? No, he didn't have to. Because Jesus had that in his heart.
Amen.
He said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father.
Yes.
You've seen the Father.
Amen.
And he just strove all the way to the garden.
Yes.
All the way to the garden. One last event came into his mind. He could have stopped it. You know, Jesus had the power to call legions
of angels.
Of angels. He could have said, oh, I've had enough of this. I'm coming home, Dad. I have got to. All these actions were in his life, and then all of a sudden, he broke through. Praise God. I'm glad he broke through. Oh, hallelujah. And he said, wait a minute. Stop right here. It's not my will. Praise the name of the Lord. When we come to a place in our hearts and our lives, and we finally come to that condition, and we say, it's not my will, but it's thy will be done. When we get to that condition, and I feel this right now. How many feel the Holy Ghost right now? When we get to the condition when we finally say, it's not my will. Lord, teach me how to walk in your way. Blessed be the Lord. Not my will. Praise God. You're wrong with people that some people sometimes is they're striving and they love the Lord, but they haven't let go yet. They haven't said, not my will. Praise the name of the Lord. Yeah, that's the hardest will to get rid of.
Amen.
That's the hardest condition to overcome.
Amen.
That's the hardest condition to overcome.
Yep.
I smoked up 4 packs a day when I was in the service. Yeah. I couldn't do it now, but I smoked 4 packs of Raleigh filters. Yuck. They were strong as could be. And you know, I overcame that. I laid them down. I quit. You know when I came to the conclusion that I quit? Because I finally said, it's enough. I quit. Praise the name of the Lord. I laid them down, and that was the end of it. Well, that's what God is wanting to do in your life. But you're not going to fight this battle by yourself. And if you haven't had the baptism baptism of the Holy Ghost, what are you waiting for? Because when you receive the Holy Ghost, you receive power. Praise God. And when the power is working in your life, yes, you have the power, not my will. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. I'd rather go to the right, but the Holy Ghost and the Word of God in you says, no, that's not the way. Keep going straight ahead. Want to dwell in the Spirit. How many are with me?
Amen.
Yeah, we got a little bit excited. Yes, we did. Of course we did.
Oh, yeah. Amen.
Praise God. There's something, I would get excited if somebody walked in this door and said, hey, there's a 2015 Camaro. I still got that kid in me, you know. Positive traction. The reason I'm saying this is because I passed one today. Woo! Positive traction. And now they got those little lights, those purple lights around them. Oh, man. Somebody walked up to me, walked in the back of the house, and said, I've got a key to the Camaro out there for you. I want to give it to you. You think I'd say, okay, thanks, buddy. Put the key in my pocket. Why no? I'd get excited. I know Brother Keith would. I'd get excited. Because they're worth about $50,000, you know. And I could sell it. But my point is this. That when the Holy Ghost gives you an insight and gives you an understanding, there's nothing wrong with getting excited about it. There's nothing wrong with shouting glory. There's nothing wrong with praising Him. Nothing wrong at all with just absolutely letting the Holy Ghost touch your mind. I've seen people get so excited because the Holy Ghost would come in, they would do a dance like that. They would fall out in the Spirit because they were excited of what they received from God.
Amen.
They didn't come to church to shout. They didn't come to church to fall out. But they responded with excitement to what God was doing for them in their life. How many are excited about what God has given you in your heart and in your life? There's nothing wrong with shouting glory. Will you do it with me? Glory! Nothing wrong with shouting praise the name of the Lord. Responsibility to follow the Spirit.
Yes.
Here's the verse of scripture. Listen to this. 8th chapter, 12th verse. Therefore, brethren, we are debtors.
Yes.
Strong word, isn't it?
We are debtors.
You know what that indicates to me? An obligation.
Yep.
An obligation. Somebody said, well, you don't have to. You know, I owe God a lot. An obligation.
Yeah.
Amen.
We, therefore, brethren, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live after the flesh. But it shows us that we are debtors. We're debtors. We didn't really know the merits of what it means with the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. You know where we're in debt for? You can't pay the price that Jesus paid. That's not. But you can be indebted. And we are indebted. Because many are called, few are chosen.
Yes.
But those that have the indwelling of God's Spirit, you're chosen. God chooses you.
Yes.
A lot of people are called, but God chooses you.
Amen.
And that,
amen.
You know what that does to me? I cannot fulfill any obligations for Jesus' death on the cross for sin. But I can say that when I receive the Spirit of God dwelling in me, I am in debt to dwell in the principles of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
I mean, just receive what I just said right there.
Yes.
I'm indebted.
Mm-hmm.
And so, how do we repay Him? We repay Him by following Him in the Spirit. Following Him. Being directed by Him. There are inevitable consequences for our lifestyle. Do you know that?
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Paul declares in the 13th verse, if you look down there, he says, for if you live after the flesh, you shall die. But if through the Spirit do mortify the deeds of the flesh or the body, you shall live. 14th verse. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. I know I'm repeating a lot of verses, but I really want to do that because tied into the thought. Because each verse has an additional thought. That's the way the Bible is. If you think you've got it all summarized and know what the Bible said, I'm gonna tell you, spend about 15 minutes with me, and I'll point out to you that there are some things that you don't know. That you need to come and hear the Word of God. You're not going to get it. Let me tell you something. I've had people say, well, and they call me to their house and they have me sit down and say, will you tell us what all you guys believe? I said, there's not enough time.
Amen.
If you come to the services faithfully,
amen,
continuously,
amen,
then you'll start to hear. And they stay with us for maybe 6 months, maybe 7 months. And they get into contest in their mind. Well, Jesus paid all of it for us, you know. That was their mindset. And when the brethren, I was out of town, and the brethren were talking about overcoming the flesh and the warfare. That was his last service. He didn't come anymore. Because you have to have a spirit and a mind willing to hear.
Yes.
Amen.
And to be in the place where you can be taught. And it doesn't come overnight.
Amen. Amen.
It doesn't get in your spirit overnight.
Amen.
But be thankful for the progress that you make.
Amen.
When you do make some progress.
Amen.
Yes.
And most important of all, rise up and share it with the church.
Amen. Amen.
So we can all be a part of what God's doing for you in your life. Yeah, well, I'm shy, I'm reluctant. You know, when the first time I was testified, I was put on the spot. I was in a youth meeting, and I'm sitting at the end of the row. And what, you know, have you ever seen that testimony thing where they point to the next guy? After you get done with your testimony, I want Sister Janice, Sister Marilyn to get up.
Praise God.
Sister Marilyn to get up.
Be ready.
You ever seen a testimony service like that?
Yes, sir.
Well, they would through everything. Well, they went through everyone in the building. And they finally come to me. You know what I did? I'm glad to be here. And that was the end of my testimony. You know why? Because I was scared to death. Scared to death to get up. But I had to overcome that fear.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Yes.
And God helps me. Now, I'm still, you know, I'm still scared to get up. I'm hesitant to get up. Because I don't want to miss the will of God.
Amen.
But
Amen.
But you get up and you share it. Because there might be someone in this congregation that's going through something that you have gone through and needs to hear that.
Amen.
Praise the name of the Lord.
Yes.
And that will bring and produce strength in that other individual's life.
Yes.
You know, it's not just hearing the Word of God, receiving the Word of God, preaching the Word of God, but there is a demonstration that will help a person to overcome whatever they're struggling with in their lives. Praise the name of the Lord.
Amen.
Oh, hallelujah.
Yes,
your
name.
If you live after the flesh, you shall die. And those who follow the Spirit, on the other hand, grow from immature state of childhood. That's children, 1 John 1 and 12. Let's just take that verse of scripture. But as many as received him, to them gave him power to become the sons. Everybody say sons.
Sons.
The sons is a maturity. Romans 8 and 14, which we've read, as many as are led by the Spirit of God, what are they?
Sons.
The sons of God. And now here he says, as many as received it, gave he power to become sons of God. All right, so if I'm born as a child, and I have to grow up, and I have to voluntarily conform to Jesus. And the conformity of Christ confirms that their conformity to Christ confirms that they are indeed born again and joint heirs with Jesus.
Amen.
And what I mean by those statements is this. I am first born with the Holy Ghost as a child.
Yes.
And when I start to conform to the teachings that I hear in this church right here, and studies I do at home, and when I get these conformities in my life and in my spirit, I become a mature person or a son of God. And the Son of God is led by the Spirit. 100% of his life. How many want to become a son of God? You know, for years I lived in church. For years I went to church. And we always had services that would be alert for new people when they came in the door, or people that were going through things. And we didn't grow. We just stayed there. We kept hanging there. But God right now is wanting to take his church and move it on into a deeper understanding to where we could become the sons of God. You know, you can't just escape and slide into heaven.
Amen.
The Bible says you got to work out your salvation with fear and trembling.
Amen.
You've got to lay down your life. You've got to conform to Jesus' life.
Amen.
You've got to study to show yourself approved, rightly dividing the word of God.
Yes.
You've got to have all these thoughts in your mind. And not only that, because I came to the mistaken understanding, I knew the mysteries. The book of Revelations is no mystery to me. I understood it.
Yeah.
But do you know what? That is not walking in the Spirit.
No.
That doesn't make a person walk in the Spirit because they know a lot.
No. No. Amen.
But the one that has the Spirit to seek after the Lord. I am hungry for more. I'm praying, God, what's next on the table? How many are praying with me? What's next on the table? Let me go ahead and die to my nature and be a child of God.
Yes.
Praise the name of the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Yes. Praise the Lord.
Afterwards, we become mature children of God by the Holy Ghost in our lives.
Yes. Amen.
God's will for us in the 10th adversity. Second chapter of Ephesians, for we are his workmanship.
Amen.
Created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God had ordained before ordained that we should walk in them. So that's what God wants us to do. He wants us to be his workmanship.
Yes.
What he would want us to be. Praise the name of the Lord. Give me a waving of your hands in honor to our King, Jesus Christ. Pray to him and say, Lord, let me be what you want me to be. Praise the name of Jesus. Don't let me be conformed to this world, but let me be transformed by the renewing of my mind. Praise the name of the Lord. God is renewing all our hearts and our minds and our goals. What is our priorities? I question you, and you question yourself internally. What is your priority? My priority is to be like Jesus and to have him in my heart, in my life. Brother Rico, you got a question?
Yeah, just a quick question. You can straighten me up on this. That's what Paul meant in Corinthians, I think it is. He said, I spoke as a child, and then he became a man. He actually became a son. Am I on the right track on that?
Absolutely. 1 Corinthians 13, isn't it? Isn't that right? Latter part of that chapter.
Yep.
When I was a child.
Yep.
Let's pull it up.
I expect as a child. I don't want to put that out of context.
You find it, Sister Stacy?
It's 13.
1 Corinthians 13. About the 11th verse, that's where he talked about divine order. charity.
Yep.
When I was a child, I spake as a child. My actions were just as a child. I understood as a child.
Yeah.
That's what happens to you when you first receive the Spirit of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Then he said, I thought as a child, but when I became a man, a son,
there it is.
I put away all those childish things. I grew up. I grew up. You know, there's got a point in our life when Jesus will not have to be our advocate any longer. Because we'll walk as he walks.
Yes.
And you know what? Somebody said, that's done after I resurrect. You know, there's no perfection in the grave.
Nope.
Ecclesiastes says it like this.
Yeah.
As a tree falleth, so shall it lie. Whatever direction it's in. If it's to the north, it's facing the north. So there's no perfection in the grave. He said, when I go to the grave, I'll be perfect. God'll resurrect me. No. No, no. If you fall, if you fall a sinner, given over to sin. Somebody said, but what about all the years that I went to church and well, let's rephrase that. Someone says, what about them that are out there in the world now and they quit church and they went backwards, they went back in the world? What about all the years that they went the church, paid their tithes? I'm going to say again, as a tree falleth, so shall it lie. We like to make excuses because we have relatives out there, you know. We like to make excuses for them. Yeah, they serve God. God certainly will recognize that. God sees them as they are.
Amen.
The condition they're in. That's hard, isn't it? Sure it is. Your emotions get involved. My emotions get involved. But you know what? If they come back, somebody said, you mean to this church? No, I'm not talking about that. Because let me tell you something, it's going to take more than just coming to this church to turn your life around.
Amen.
Did you hear what I said?
Yes.
Just walking in this church building, you can sit here for 1,000 years and still not have your life turned around.
Correct.
But if you, if they committed their lives back to the Lord and come set and listen, all that knowledge they attained years ago will come back to them.
Yep.
It'll add to their knowledge. They have to repent, though. Have to repent. Somebody, you know, that's hard, and I, you know, somebody said I shoot from the hip, but I do, because I think it's vital. It's vital. It's vital for people to understand that you can't just go back out in the world and live like the world and expect a righteous resurrection. Doesn't work that way. Condition of your heart. Well, their condition is right. They're out in the world, the condition isn't right, isn't it? Is their heart right? Can't be right. They're living according to the world. You know what they're living by? As we have been discussing for an hour, they're being led by the flesh.
Yes.
What did Paul say happens to people that are led by the flesh? They shall what? Surely die. But now what if someone dies striving? Everybody say striving.
Striving
to overcome. You know what happens to them? As a tree falleth, so shall it lie. And when God resurrects that person, in other words, they'll have that spirit of striving in their hearts.
Yes.
And that spirit of striving will help them to finish the job of overcoming their nature and their flesh. And somebody said, well, do you mean if they don't, then they go to hell? Can you imagine a person that had been in the grave and resurrected from the grave and they were striving? Do you think that individual will backslide? I should hope not. They're going to finish their course. They're going to receive their crown. Praise the name of the Lord. And that overcomer. Now then, what about the fellow that reaches perfection Guess what? That tree's not going to lie. That tree is going to move out a live soul.
Yes, amen.
And inhabit another house, Jesus said. Remember that 14th chapter of John? He said, I have prepared a place for you, that where I am you may be also. And in my Father's house, that's where he's at, in my Father's house, there's many mansions. Praise the name of the Lord. That's where that person will go. And you know what? I'm striving to move out of this body into another body. To be an overcomer in Christ Jesus. All right, Sister Gill, did you have your hand up?
No.
Okay, you want to say something? Go ahead.
No, I didn't.
Oh, okay, I'm sorry.
Praise the Lord.
You're praising the Lord, all right. Praise the Lord, yes, sir.
I'd like to say something.
All right.
I'm here because Rico is my best friend.
Yes, sir. I know he is.
And my wife and I attend another church and have for years. But the more I go to that church, the more I have learned. I gave a talk at what's called Promise Keepers. It's a men's religious deal, non-denominational. And what was interesting, my talk was on why the so-called good Christians have such a fear of dying. And in the audience, there were 47 ministers. I asked for a show of hands of those that have this so-called fear. 21 raised their hand.
Oh, man.
And I called on a couple of the ministers, and I said, what is your fear? What do you fear? And they said, along with a number of other ones, the unknown. Can you imagine that? And I said, my gosh, what is faith all about?
They're teaching others.
And the other thing is, I had given a talk once about the fact that so many people, well, let me back up a minute. My mother had a wonderful saying. She said, I'm never going to die. I'm just going to have a change of address in heaven. And I thought, does that say it all?
Yeah.
Well, the other thing is, and I'm just rambling here on thoughts, but the other thing is, I've had so many people come up to me and say, Richard, in the Twin Towers, if you had lost a wife or a loved one, wouldn't you want to have their remains found? And I said, that is the furthest thing from my mind. I said, my feeling, I believe, is when they took their last breath, their spirit is in heaven, the tabernacle, the house, the spirit is nothing, you know, and they look at you like, my gosh, what is that all about? Or the finality, if you will, that people feel that they have to recover the body, like this recent air crash. And all I'm saying by this is, when you're right with the Lord and you believe and you know where you're going, what is there to fear or even worry about? And that's another thing with me. And that is, I have people that say, Richard, I'm not sleeping well at night. I'm worried about a multitude of problems. I said, what is wrong with turning those problems and concerns over to the Lord? Get your good night's sleep. And I said, you know, the funny thing is, 90% of these fears will never come to fruition. They will pass, and you'll think, my gosh, isn't that wonderful?
Yeah.
Anyway, I just thought. But I do want to commend Brother here for his outstanding conveyance of the Word of God. And all. So many churches today are there strictly for the money and the, I would say, more and more as time goes on. They're there for the camaraderie.
Yes.
The getting together and anyway, wonderful.
Amen.
Glad to have Brother Richard. He's been here before and was a blessing, and we appreciate him coming by. And I would like to call the chief usher up, please.
Gus?
Yes.
Gus? Wait a minute, Gus. Oh, you want to say something?
You go ahead. No, sir. You go ahead and pray, because.
You
pray over me and pray.
All right. We're going to take the offering right now, Brother Rico, okay. And then after the offering, we'll have prayer. Would that be all right?
Okay.
All right.
I have a message. I
need
to pray over you.
Okay, we will.
Like old kings, they remember.
You know, that's one thing that I, last night, let me just say this, please listen to me, please. That's one thing the Lord spoke to my heart about, and that is, we need to encourage everyone, when there's a season for prayer, that they come forward.
Amen.
And let's pray for one another.
Amen, yes.
You know, I need your help.
Amen.
I need your help. I do.
Amen.
Well, the chief usher's taken off. Okay. We're going to, and he's got an assistant now. Okay. All right. Let's take the offering. Let's sing a song. And I'll say more about this prayer. Please give. Please help the church. As you know, there's no salary that goes in my pocket.